Good evening. Great. This looks so great. I'm just so glad everybody's here. My name's Chuck Swanson. I'm the director of Hancher. And first of all, I just can't believe that we're just a few days away from the preview performances of Christopher Wheeldon's Nutcracker for the Joffrey Ballet. We have been waiting for this for a long, long time. Hancher and the University of Iowa are very proud to be producing sponsor of this production and to give our community a chance to see this new work on our new stage before its official premiere in Chicago. So I want to give you a little bit of history of Hancher and the University of Iowa and the Joffrey. As many of you know, Hancher's relationship with the Joffrey Ballet is both longstanding and robust. Highlights over the years include extended Iowa dance residencies in the early 1980s, Hancher's very first commission, and we've now commissioned over 100 pieces of new work, was back in 1986, titled Heart of the Matter, choreographed by James Kadelka. Then the commissioning and world premiere of the first rock ballet ever, called Billboards, in 1993, featuring music by Prince, who everybody knows Prince, or knew Prince. Then the 30th anniversary River to River tour in 2007, that saw the Joffrey perform outdoors in five Iowa communities for more than 35,000 people as a gift to the state. And then, of course, the commissioning and world premiere of Robert Joffrey's Nutcracker, which opened on the original Hancher stage almost 29 years ago to the very day. We presented runs of Robert Joffrey's Nutcracker six times, the last time being in 2004. And over 400 young people from Iowa have danced from around our community, and they were part of this magical production. And so we're proud that this tradition continues. And I know we have some dancers here tonight, I know I see one anyway, who will be in this new Nutcracker. We can't wait to see this happen on the stage. So I hope all of you will be joining us for one of these five performances of the Nutcracker here at Hancher. The first preview performance is this Thursday night, and performances continue through Sunday afternoon before the Joffrey returns to Chicago for a month-long run at the Auditorium Theater. This is a huge undertaking, and once again, I want to share the pride that Hancher and the University of Iowa take in having to make this happen. We are grateful to our donors, and as a university, this is a perfect example of bringing together some of the most creative minds in the world today and helping with the birth of something very unique and very special. I don't think it gets any better than that. So, now a quick introduction of our panelists. First of all, Ashley Weider. Ashley is the artistic director of the Joffrey Ballet. He was a member of the company and danced in the Nutcracker on the Hancher stage in 1987. Next, April Daly. April Daly has been with the Joffrey since 2003 and was a part of our River to River tour. And I'll never forget seeing her on that stage. In 2009, Dance Magazine declared her on the rise. And then we have Christopher Wheeldon, who I'm just so excited to know that he's here at Hancher Auditorium in the University of Iowa for just about 2 weeks. Chris, that is just so cool. That's so exciting. One of the most in-demand choreographers working today, and he was winner of the 2015 Tony Award for the Best Choreographer for an American in Paris. Wow. And Julian Crouch, who I've gotten to know, and he's just such a gentleman, such a sweetheart. Julian is a Tony-nominated set and costume designer whose work included Hedwig and the Angry Inch and Shock-Headed Peter. And then the panelist will be moderated by Rebecca Ritzel, who recently joined the Minneapolis Star Tribune staff as a performing arts critic and reporter. Prior to arriving in Minneapolis, she spent 8 years as a freelance dance critic for the Washington Post. The Creative Matter Lecture Series is helping to co-sponsor tonight's event with Hancher, and we thank them for their support. With that, please help me in joining the panel.
Thank you all so much for coming tonight. I want to start by saying that my career this year has, in a way, it's paralleled Christopher Wheeldon's. This is going to be my third Christopher Wheeldon full-length story ballet this year. I had the privilege in Washington of the last time we talked of writing about The Winter's Tale, which was his joint commission for the National Ballet of Canada and the Royal Ballet. And then I just got to see his Cinderella, which was a joint commission between Dutch National and the San Francisco Ballet, which was wonderful, and also included Julian's work, correct? And now we're here, both here in the Midwest. I'm at the Star Tribune, and Christopher's here is sort of, and everyone being here is testimony to the fact that great art can happen here, not just at the Kennedy Center and at other, you know, halls around the world. So I wanted to see if we could start by talking about how it is that Christopher and the rest of the team have decided what to choose to include in this Nutcracker. What were the sacred things that they really wanted to keep, and what were the things that they had to change? If any of you saw Alistair McCulley's review of Two Nutcrackers over the weekend, he noted that one of the major differences between Nutcrackers is that in some companies spell the Sugar Plum Fairy as one word, and some people spell Sugar Plum as two. And this is being upheld by the New York Times as a major distinction between Nutcrackers. What the folks at this table have done here is done away with the Sugar Plum Fairy altogether. So, does that give you enough to go in there? Sorry.
It's a sugar-free Nutcracker.
It's not
sugar-free.
It's actually a little, yeah. Well, we haven't taken away Christmas, so that's a good start. I think often
people's fears sort of kick in when they hear that there's going to be, you know, a reinvention. But actually, you know, much of our version of the Nutcracker story is still kind of based and structured the same way that a traditional Nutcracker is structured, mostly because of the music, because the music really dictates the action. And, you know, it's wonderful storytelling music. It's and I think of all the Tchaikovsky scores, it's kind of the leanest and really presents some of the most beautiful melodies that he ever wrote. So I suppose the major difference of our production is the setting. The fact that we decided to make our protagonist a little girl, the daughter of immigrant workers working on the construction of the World's Fair, a single parent family. We're not too sure what happened to father. That's sort of left to the imagination. And make our version of the story about community, as well as family, of course. Community, a community of people who come together, who have very little, but who create magic. And so the magic then is born from this quite creative group of people, in a sense, and overseen by a Drosselmeyer-like character. We call him the Great Impresario, who is, I suppose you could liken him to a kind of Daniel Burnham. I keep saying, you know, Daniel Burnham, Tesla, P.T. Barnum, kind of a showman of that, you know, of that time. So he comes to this worker's hut on Christmas Eve to reward his workers who are building this magnificent fairground for him and for the world. So I suppose that's probably the largest innovation, is that it's not about a wealthy Victorian child who grows up in and has this privileged lifestyle and a wonderful Christmas Eve party, and then she falls asleep and dreams of more goodies. This is a child who is missing something that's very important to a child, missing a parent, and who is a member of this community. And so her journey, she's rewarded at the end of this journey with more than just candy. Let's leave it at that for now, without giving too much away.
Mm-hmm. And I really think that this World's Fair conceit is pretty genius, because it allows them to logically proceed with the divertissement in the second act. And there are going to be Chinese dragons. There will not be any Russian dancers, but there will be Buffalo Bill Cody, a Wild West show, which actually happened on the outskirts of the fair. It was like the fringe festival of the World's Fair.
They didn't let him in, actually. He wasn't, for some reason, he wasn't licensed to perform on the fairground. He wasn't part of the selection. And so, sort of in protest, he set up right outside the fairground gates and, you know, took a lot of the... not that the fair was suffering for numbers of people, but I think his show did very well, because many of the people that came out and went into the fair went to see his show as well.
And I am curious exactly where the idea came from to use the World's Fair. It does make sense. This morning I happened to meet Dylan, who is playing Fritz in Act One. he's a Chicago area young dancer, and he told me that he actually studied the World's Fair in fourth grade. However, he doesn't remember, because that was a long time ago, and he's now in seventh grade.
That is really sweet.
Yes. So kids in Chicago do still have a little bit of a concept of the World's Fair, but how did you hone in on that idea, and what do you think people in Chicago or the rest of the Midwest know about the World's Fair?
Well, I think most people probably know about the World's Fair from the Eric Larson novel Devil in the White City, which was hugely, I think that took the subject of the World's Fair out into the world. Certainly how I was aware that there had been a World's Fair in Chicago, but I learned so much about, the pulling all of the elements together. It feels a little like pulling all the elements of a Nutcracker together, actually. And the politics that were involved, and of course, the serial killer that we've kept out of this production of the Nutcracker. No serial killer in this one. But I can't take credit for the idea initially. It was actually, Ashley, when he came to me and when we started discussing a Nutcracker for Joffrey Ballet, he really wanted a production that was specifically made for the Joffrey and for the city of Chicago. And so, so the World's Fair idea really started with Ash. So maybe you want to have him answer that question.
So I think, good evening, everyone. I think that when I was appointed the director of the Joffrey Ballet in 2007, I was still working at San Francisco Ballet, but I was also working with Christopher in New York with his own company, Morphosis. And as I kind of got to know Chicago and the wonderful people of Chicago, and a city that is steeped in incredible history, it has suffered great disasters, but also great successes. And so on top of there was the disaster of the fire of Chicago, which kind of wiped the city out, and then the rebuilding, and then the World's Fair came right on top of that. And it kind of galvanized the city and became a really focal point for the city. And it attracted millions and millions of people to Chicago. And I think that many of us know that the electric light bulb was kind of debuted at the World's Fair, the Ferris wheel. There were so many things that came out of that fair. So the more I read about it and thinking about this idea that Chris and I had over a lunch in New York about he'd never done a Nutcracker, and I knew that as much as I loved Robert Joffrey's Nutcracker, it was completely falling apart, and we had to do something. So were we going to rebuild it and keep it the same, or were we going to take this opportunity to have one of the best living, breathing choreographers in the world today come and work with the Joffrey and kind of reimagine what the Nutcracker looks like? So the World's Fair for me just seemed an amazing journey for a country that is made up of immigrants. We all come from somewhere. I think that the values of the Nutcracker are in our humanity, not in gifts. And I think that to re-look at what family means and what community means and how we celebrate that in a really magical way just seemed the right place. And for Marie, to be able to travel through the World's Fair and to explore the pavilions that were built at the World's Fair. It had a continuing journey.
And then one of the things that Julian has done is picked up on certain icons, if you will, of the fair, some of which you may need to Wikipedia. I know I did. But you had a chance to pick and choose what it is that you wanted to have in the background. For example, there's even a palm tree. And I was sort of like, why is there a palm tree as I was watching rehearsal? But there's a reason. So would you talk a little bit about how you picked and chose the images?
Well, I mean, to be honest, we had a lot to pick from. Mm-hmm. It actually is not hard in a way. It is, there was so much there. I think that in terms of, I mean, to be honest, I'm mostly trying to pick Chris's brain, and mostly I think design is a kind of fortune telling, where you know you're trying to, you know, I did the design for this over a year ago. And you're trying, and you're imagining what it's going to be like to be right here now, where we are, putting this together. So mostly though, I'm trying to pick Chris's brain and deliver the vision he wants. Then within that, I could think I get to play around a little bit when he's not looking.
And that, I think, though, you know, even though Julian is an excellent designer, but I think that partly maybe speaks to Chris's ability to pick collaborators who you can work with so well. And you tend to see what I think your strengths are as a choreographer, or what you see you need help with, and identifying the people who can help you forward the entire story. And if you look back at some of Chris's other full-length ballets, you worked with Nicholas Wright on Alice in Wonderland, who's a British playwright. And for Winter's Tale, you actually had help from Nicholas, I always mispronounce his name, Nicholas Heitner, yes, right, who has been director of the National Theater. And I just wrote about this for the Washington Post recently, and I got to, you know, talk to Chris, talk to Nick, and I thought, how cool is this, that a choreographer and a great British theater director walked into a bar and started talking about Shakespeare. Well, that sounds like a great high-low culture mix. Then very recently, I have to admit that I was, you know, having a girls' night with a friend. There may have been a bottle of wine involved, and we decided to watch Center Stage. That's how you know Nicholas Heitner,
yeah.
Isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
Yes.
It is.
Yes. Okay, thank you. We have a few Center Stage fans over here. But, okay, so if you could talk a little bit about your collaborative process, and we also have involved here with this Nutcracker, the children's book writer, Brian O'Selznick, who is probably best known for the book that became the movie Hugo. And Basil Twist, the puppeteer, who I just can't wait to see what he's done with the Christmas tree. So maybe talk a little bit more about the collaborative process and how you chose the rest of the team for the Nutcracker.
Well, I believe that, you know, the ballet can be, there are places for all types of ballet. I still love working in the abstract. I still love the simplicity of the leotard and an empty stage and dance as the sort of the primary focus. But I think with a story ballet like The Nutcracker, maybe more so The Nutcracker than any of the story ballets that I've worked on so far, I believe in dynamic theater and that all of the elements need to sort of marry together to make an exciting theatrical event. Sometimes ballet productions get sort of a bad rap and people think, you know, that they're sort of a bit kind of staid and old-fashioned. And so, you know, I'm keen on working with great people like Julian and Basil and Natasha Katz, the lighting designer, and 59 Productions, our projection designers, to take audiences on a real journey. Of course, dance is the language, is the primary storytelling language, but sometimes that needs a little bit of help. And so when you have great people around you, again, and as you said, understanding what it is you do well and what you might need a little bit of help with, sometimes the stories become a little kind of blurry and are difficult to follow. And the Nutcracker, we have such a responsibility with the Nutcracker because the Nutcracker is going to be sort of the many children's first theatrical experience, first time going to the theatre. It's sort of a gateway to what we hope will be an audience of the future. Everybody remembers their first Nutcracker. And so if it can be a dynamic, exciting experience, then there's hope to sort of build audiences for other productions of the ballet in the future.
Yeah. Maybe Ashley and April can talk a little bit about how that building, you know, was distinct working with Christopher here. Now, you've also done Christopher Swan Lake, but this is your first, and then obviously there's more abstract ballets that are in the company's repertoire, but a little bit about what that process was been like, especially in the studio. And I know, April, I've heard that Christopher likes to demonstrate quite a bit and perhaps more than some choreographers.
Well, it's been an amazing experience so far. We have been fortunate to dance a number of Chris's ballets, I believe like seven over the last 8 years. So we've developed a relationship with him, and he's really gotten to know the company. So I think with that base already coming in to do this brand new production, we knew each other on a different level. So it wasn't just kind of meeting the dancers and see what we can do. He saw what we were capable of doing. So I feel like working with him in the studio, he really pushes us to our limits. I feel like I was sitting in the house watching rehearsals and talking with some dancers about how amazing our fellow dancers look and that they're dancing better than ever. And I think a large part of that is because Chris knows what we're capable of doing. And even in the beginning, I remember working on what is the Sugar Plum variation and some of the steps he was doing. It's very intricate footwork and thinking like, this is never going to happen. I can't get this. And he's like, you'll get it. Keep working it. And now here we are getting ready to perform. And it's like, yes, it's possible. And he knew it and it's happening. And I think that's really incredible. And yes, he does like to demonstrate and get into character and show us, but he's a great coach too. You know, he'll see us and be like, that's not quite right. And he knows how to direct everybody. He sees we all work differently. We don't react the same way. And so he really knows how to look at you and see how to get the best kind of like acting and dancing out of the dancers. So it's really special.
And I would say that, you know, I've been a huge, huge fan of Chris's work ever since he started choreographing at New York City Ballet. And then I had the opportunity in San Francisco to work with him on quite a few creations. And so when I took over the Joffrey, Chicago had not really seen a lot of Chris's work. And so, you know, I felt that I wanted to give our audience access to his work. So I remember we opened with Carousel, a dance, which was just a phenomenal invitation for the audience to kind of have access to what Chris was capable of. And over the years, we've done more and more, both abstract and narrative. Swan Lake, which we presented 2 years ago, has been the greatest success for the Joffrey Ballet. And I think that a lot of people thought the Joffrey Ballet and Swan Lake would never, ever, ever go together. But I think that how Christopher sees a narrative and how he puts that narrative into the language of ballet is a really beautiful thing that all of us understand. And so it's been an amazing journey for not only the company, but also for our audience. And I think that for all of you here to see what he has created for the Nutcracker, it's really a gift.
I'd like that, you know, April mentioned acting just a bit, and for, you know, as Chuck mentioned, you know, Christopher got sort of, even though those of us in the ballet world know he's a big deal, we had to share him with American in Paris. And I'm really curious what sort of tools of the trade and tricks and conventions you've carried over from the theatrical world, which you've mentioned, and Julian, have now come into the ballet world that maybe would not have otherwise been part of the production or would have been an addition to the process. And I think we're seeing it here, even though the last Nutcracker got to try out at Hancher, this is like an out-of-town tryout is what we call it in the theater world. So what did you learn from that experience that now you're doing differently in the creation of this full-length work?
I suppose in a way, you know, what's interesting about working in theater and working with actors is actors actors can't move from A to B without knowing why they have to do that. And that can sometimes be incredibly infuriating, but actually more than that on a higher level, it's really interesting because it forces you as a director to really think through every moment and really be focusing on not just what's happening in the center, but also what's happening sort of on the periphery. And sometimes again, ballet tends to, we sort of sometimes brush that aside. Like if you're a peasant number four in Giselle, you're kind of standing at the side with your hands on your hips. It doesn't really matter what you're doing as long as every now and then you lift an arm. You know, and so what I'm trying to encourage the dancers and the kids as well. It's great working with the kids and trying to give every individual on the stage a purpose, whether they're, you know, just a parent in the party scene, give everyone a character, and encourage everyone to understand, you know, where they've come from or think for themselves. Because, you know, when you've got a cast the size of the Nutcracker, you can't go around and write an individual synopsis for each dancer, but encourage them to know when they come into the Christmas party, where they've come from, what their situation is at home, and where they're going when they leave the scene. Mm-hmm. So that, I think, has definitely, having that experience on Broadway has definitely sort of influenced the way that I encourage the dancers to really develop a character for themselves. And because every single person on that stage contributes to the journey that the audience is experiencing. So if you're, you know, sitting over on a chair behind the table and just, you know, just decorating the set, as it were, then you know, some of that texture, some of that atmosphere gets lost. So I suppose that's been, you know, the biggest change for me.
And I think that could be even reflected in the dancers. I know I've talked to Robbie Fairchild, who was your Tony nominee lead, and he said he'll never look at an entrance the same way. You know, that in ballet we think of, oh, the prince comes out and, you know, puts a hand on his hip and he's ready to go, and that he'll never walk out on stage the same way. April, can you share any character background of, and then in the first act, which said that you are sort of the mother character, and then there'll be a carryover and a sort of dream sequence version of your character in the second act, and share what you want and what have you thought, you know, at what, in terms of your development of the character?
How much am I at liberty to say?
I don't know.
I don't want to give it away because it's so beautiful. And I want you all to have the same surprise I had, like when Chris said it, and I was like, oh, I just got goosebumps imagining it. There's some really beautiful moments.
Don't,
but
give it all away.
I know, I'm not going
to. Just not the end.
But look, guys, casting is up and on the internet, so anyone can see the list of characters.
Okay.
Right?
So that's, okay, great. So, yes, in this version, so the sugar plum is called the Golden Statue. And that's the Sugar Plum Fairy. And she is the mother in the first act. So, and I love, I don't know if it's later in my career, but roles that have a lot more depth and artistry that you can, it's not just getting on stage and smiling or having, but you know, when you can really get into a role is really special. And so I think being involved from the beginning, from act one and coming out in the first scene, you're part of the Nutcracker from the very beginning, and you get to develop the role. And I think when Marie starts her journey into the second act and she discovers the golden statue and sees like a similarity there and feels something, wait, I know her, I've seen her before. And I think there's these really special connections between, in the story, there's little, I don't want to give it away. I don't know how to say. I don't know. There's a lot to sink your teeth into. Like there, it's not just like I'm the Sugar Plum Fairy and my tiara and my pink tutu and this is my magical land, which is glorious and I love, and I think that's Nutcracker also and so special. But this is similar but completely different, and it just has so many more levels from the very beginning. And I think that's been really fun. That on top of just the dancing, there's a lot of depth to all of the characters, and it's fun.
I think also that, you know, when we did Swan Lake and Chris came to Chicago and we worked really hard on Swan Lake, and then when he left, he wrote to the company and said, you know, find purpose in every single thought, in every gesture, in the way you dance, and what does it mean to do these different roles within a work. And that if you find that intention, everything, as Chris was saying, everything then is a complete picture. And you've got a company that is moving all in the same direction, which I think is kind of imperative if we're going to really succeed in our art form.
I want to say, can I add a little something to it? What's really special is that we've done a lot of his works that have already been created on other companies, and then they're set on us. And so we're dancing already made roles. So this is special because he created it on us. So in the creative process, there's a lot of back and forth. So if something doesn't feel right, or he'll look and he'll say, how did that feel? Did that feel good? Or how can we make that better? How can we make that more natural for you? And I think having that makes us much more unique to the Joffrey, because all of the roles were created on us. So it's got a different feel too.
There were some classic moments where I would go into rehearsal with the five ladies that are learning the Golden Statue. And every day we were in the same studio, sort of on the backside of the studio complex. And I'd walk in, and they all kind of had their own space in the room. They're very respectful of one another. It's not like get out of my way, you know. I'm the first cast. They're all very respectful, and so they would sort of line themselves up, equally spaced, all five of them across the back of the studio, and then they would carve out their own space to dance the solo, which of course doesn't really work because you need to cover all of the space to really understand how the movement's going to work in a bigger space. But there'd be moments where I would be facing the mirror and there'd be this wall of gorgeous ballerinas behind me, and I'd show a step, and they'd just, if they liked the step, you could tell because they'd practice it. And if there was a step that they didn't think was going to look good on them or work, quite frankly, they'd just stand there. And you could just...
I don't know what you're talking
about.
So
you could just kind of feel it. And use the back of your, the hairs on the back of your neck bristle a little bit. And so then I would turn and I'd be like, is anyone going to try it? And of course, someone would valiantly try it. And it doesn't, like April was saying, my movement is... it's not straightforward. It's often off kilter. I am often asking for them to contract in ways that makes the point work really challenging. It's not just straight up and down. I like expansive movement, and sometimes that's a little bit scary when you're still trying to figure it out. So it's very much a process. And then I went away for a few weeks, and I came back, and they were already starting to look much better on their bodies. And so it's all a process, but these guys are lovely to work with. They're very collaborative, and it's also it's also fun in the studio. We have a good time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We're gonna open the floor for audience questions, but I was wondering if first Ashley would be willing to share a memory or two from the performances here in the creation of the first Nutcracker.
Absolutely. I have to say that, because I wanted to respond to Chuck as well, but the relationship between the Joffrey Ballet and Hancher and the University of Iowa is really a quite extraordinary, unique opportunity for all of us. And it feels like coming home here, because I've danced here so many times. I won't get to dance at this beautiful theater that you've built, but I have many, many great memories of Hancher. And so I remember that first night when we presented Robert Joffrey's Nutcracker, and it was a really huge deal. The Joffrey had never done a Nutcracker. Joffrey knew that it was essential that we had one. And even though the process was very difficult because Robert Joffrey was not so well at that time, so we never got to see enough of him. But the response from the people of Iowa and from all the people that have supported Hancher, that have supported the Joffrey over all these years, is really an amazing feeling. And when you have that support behind you, it's just you're a team. Like, we're all a team here. So all we want is success. And we want to engage, and we want to make sure that we have a future generation that loves the art form as much as we do. So that opening night was really, really a magical moment. And I can promise you something on Thursday night, too.
All right. Do we have any questions from out here? And I'll repeat, if you want to say your question, then as long as I've got it, I'll repeat it for everyone, make sure everyone else has heard. Okay. Yes.
Yeah, it's actually one of the most challenging rehearsal processes I've had so far because, you know, it's already challenging having a large number of kids in the work. You know, we have to work around, obviously, the school hours and everything takes longer. It's great fun, but when you're working and you're trying to create something that's perhaps a little bit more complex than a straightforward Nutcracker, it can be very tiring because we, you know, we have our kids' rehearsals in the evening after a six-hour day rehearsing with the company. And but there's also something really fantastic about seeing everything start to click for them and to see them start to invent for themselves. We worked with the Chicago kids, I mean, on and off since the beginning of August. So coming up here and the group that have been working up here, the ballet master that's been working with them up here from Joffrey and also the local ballet masters have done a really fantastic job. I was very nervous because I didn't really know what to expect. We've got very little time. They've just had to be sort of plugged into the production in a way. And so I'm seeing them for the first time, along with I'm seeing the theater for the first time and the production for the first time, the scenery, the costumes, the lighting. So it's been a huge relief to have this great group of kids. And of course, we're pushing them every day and they're gonna get better and there's still a lot of work to do. But and then as far as the rest of the production is concerned, I said to the company a couple of days ago over the mic, because you kind of feel everybody getting fearful at this stage because the pressure's on. And even though these are previews, of course, we want to deliver something as marvelous as what we're going to be delivering in Chicago. We want to create something really great for you guys. So yes, it's previews, but it's really opening. So people get nervous, there's tension. And so I said to the company, look, just remember, because many of them haven't been through this process before, on this scale anyway. And I have, so I've had a little bit of experience. And just to remember that it's going to be chaos right up until the opening. All of these elements sort of crashing together, tumbling together at the same time, creates a lot of chaos. And you know, eventually that chaos sort of subsides and something really beautiful happens. And you know, maybe it's not absolutely right the first time round. Maybe there are things that we will work on between our opening here on Thursday and Chicago, and then again between this year and next year. I've been working on Winter's Tale for a couple of years. I've been working on Alice's Adventures in Wonderland. I still go in there and tweak. So, you know, that's one of the joys of having a recurring production. You can make it better and make improvements. But I suppose the short answer to this question is we are still living in chaos. But we shall emerge. We shall emerge.
And I was able to, at the rehearsal I saw yesterday, see some of the local kids in action. And Christopher does a great job of giving them notes. You told that one child did not get off stage quite quick enough, and you told her to, I believe, skedaddle.
Skedaddle,
yes. Yes, skedaddle, yeah, yes. Yeah. So there is all the children are being very well treated. No wrath of the angry choreographer. So, anyone else? Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I'll try and speak properly into my microphone. I did Cinderella with Chris. Four years ago.
Yeah.
And actually, very soon after that, I was very flattered that he talked about this. So it was a long time coming. I don't think we did anything for 2 years, but I started buying the books about the World's Fair. And I suppose the starting place for me usually is like a massive amount of picture research, which is part work and part putting it off. You know, it's and it used to be in libraries, and now it's on the internet, and you know. So for me, I start looking at pictures, and I can't, and I'll collect a huge amount. I'm looking for things that kind of flirt with me in some way. I don't always know why. Some of it's very obvious, so pictures of the World Fair, and then there's other things where you just think, well, I'm intrigued by this image. So that's how I start. And then it obviously shifts into a different gear when Chris and I work together, and that's when I was talking about trying to read his mind and trying to find out where he is. I think one thing that was very obvious to me very early on was that the Chicago World's Fair was called the White City, and that white isn't quite enough for the whole of a Nutcracker. So I think what happens, and this happens, I think, whenever you do something that involves realism and historical research, you have to kind of find where that meets theatricality and fantasy, and especially this ballet more than anything else, because I think we really wanted to deliver what everyone would want, but not necessarily in exactly the same way. So I suppose the process then is kind of weighing up this research with what you sort of dream of doing that's not necessarily in the research. So I suppose that's the next stage. I'm a little scared of costume design, and Chris, well, the two times I worked with Chris, he's asked me to, but I feel like a little bit of a novice with that. I feel I can draw a costume and know what it should look like, but I don't do it a huge amount, and ballet is a really, really technical area, so I left that on the back burner as long as possible and stuck to my comfort zone. I didn't train in theatre, so I started in theatre really as a mask maker. As a kid, I would make masks, and I think that's one reason why Chris came to me. So I definitely was thinking a little bit about that, and it's hard to say, because I think really it's just like a big web of overlapping things, and then my ideas, then Chris's ideas, and then I knew Brian Selznick, so I guess that was one thing that I brought that people wouldn't expect that to come through the design in a way. And then I got scared because Brian, I don't know if people know Brian Selznick, but he's like a graphic artist and fantastic. And then I thought, oh no, I brought someone in who can draw better than me. that was part of the process. So really it's just like a very long cooking of different ingredients, and you know, at certain points you sort of discover you're going down the wrong path and you need to shift and change. It's just like anything else in life.
And I think that maybe if I can, just speaking of Cinderella, there's a gorgeous carryover between the sets and the costumes that hopefully we'll see in the Nutcracker too. So even though it may be, you know, yeah, maybe no, you felt
reason,
under
there's
your
a very good set. Reason for having the same scene design, costume designer. But what I need actually, and which I've had, is I need fantastic assistance, which fortunately the Joffrey has supplied. So you know, I get a lot of help. I get a lot of help from these guys as well, because of course they've worn these clothes. You know, they've worn clothes to be danced in, and so they know far more than I do. So I get a lot of support in order to do that.
Yeah. And April gets a great reveal moment to reveal some of those clothes, right? Other questions? Thank you.
Yes, I have two questions, actually. One is that the original Nutcracker that is now no longer, what happens to that? And then going forward, I mean, if that lasted for, what, 29 years, did you say?
Yes.
How
I mean, I think the thing with the old production is that it got to the point where the scenery was that so much paint had come off the drops. I mean, we were asking the lighting designer to really be a magician. And the wood was rotten, and so it was actually not very safe, and the clothes were, they were in rags. I mean, even last year, a little girl, I said, oh, how are you? And she said, you know, she said, I am wearing rags. She said, my costume has so many holes in it. So, so it was just time to really say it had done a fantastic job. And we have not got rid of the production. I think that because of Kermit Love, and he was so involved in that production, especially the Mother Ginger and the mice heads, that the Chicago History Museum is interested in preserving some of it. And also, the costume design was by John David Ridge, who had been head of Holston Couture for years and years and years. So there are some of the original costumes that as tatty as they are, have been preserved. They haven't been worn for years. So I'm hoping that this production lasts another 29 years.
Let's shoot for 30.
That's a great question, thank you. One or two more, maybe? Or should we end on, okay, thank you.
I know we don't have Basil Twist here, but I'm hoping maybe someone would be willing to speak a little bit to the puppetry and how that came to be and how that fits in the story.
Basil was with Chris and I when we did Cinderella, so in some ways he's part of that kind of team. For me, it's strange because I do puppetry, but doing set and costume, there's no way I could do that element as well. So I work with Basil's my go-to guy for that, and he can definitely do things that I can't do. He's fantastic with fabric and he's funny. I mean, Basil, because he brings a real different energy, doesn't he? He sort of scrabbles around and he pulls things together, and he's incredibly hands-on, and he brings a different personality into the mix.
Yeah, I mean, I've been a huge fan of Basil's work and really, really wanted to work with him. And so when he said yes to Cinderella, I was thrilled. And he only did one thing on Cinderella. He created the most miraculous coach.
He did the tree.
And actually, we discovered in Cinderella, really because of poor workmanship from the scenic shop. The tree, you know, we got the tree to the stage the first day, and it really did not look good. It kind of looked a little bit like a kindergarten project. And we were in a bit of a panic because we were relying on this tree to not only look magnificent, but also do quite a few. Basil designed this sort of rope pulley system so that the branches of the tree would come down and then they would reveal a character and then they would go away. So not only did the tree not look good, it didn't work. The pulley system that they'd rigged wasn't to his design specifications, and they couldn't figure out a way to make it work. So we were in a bit of a state, and kind of as a last resort, the projection designer that we were working with on that production said, well, you know, let me photograph the tree and manipulate the images and we'll project it back onto itself. And the results are absolutely spectacular. And I think actually that moment for me was quite sort of transformative in the way that I like to see stage design, and how the combination of projection used with paint, with, you know, kind of traditional painted scenery. I don't think projection works very well on its own. I don't think projection works very well when you're competing with live action, because our eyes now are so attuned to screens and moving image that you'll always go to the moving image before you'll go to the live action. But the right combination, sort of a marriage, a blending of traditional scenery and subtle projection, painterly projection, is something quite extraordinary. So I've deviated. Anyway, Basil. so the Nutcracker seemed, it just seemed such an obvious collaboration. There are so many kind of magnificent opportunities for puppetry, stagecraft in the show. There are mice, and of course the children play the mice as well. But we've got some fantastic mice, rats. I should call them rats because they really are rats. The tree, of course, the magical growing Christmas tree. There's a journey at the beginning of Act Two. So Basil he's a genius with silk. So we've got some lovely silk work. Again, it sort of ties into the idea of a really dynamic theatrical experience and bringing all of these incredible people together and then bossing them around.
Actually, Basil also, he took a bit of persuading on this job because he got one of those MacArthur Genius Grants. And actually, he's now designing his own ballet for... Where's he doing that for?
In Columbus, actually, for Ballet Met.
So he took a little bit of... We had to net him in for this one. But he's probably still down there working.
Yeah.
And I think also, because the company had never worked with Basil, and we workshopped for a couple of weeks with Basil, and so they learned how do you make a rat look amazingly realistic, and how do you make a water ripple? And so I think that, it's another dimension to our lives as artists, that we're not just about ballet, dancing the steps, but actually about being part of theatre. Mm-hmm. And Basil's very much part of theatre. So
Those were some interesting afternoons too, because Basil is, as Julian said, he's very hands-on, and he's very, he can make something out of anything. He could make this water bottle into something beautiful. When you're with a group of people like dancers who don't have this experience very often, So we'd have these three-hour blocks in the afternoons where the entire company were called, and they'd sit there, and Basil would be, just having this incredible relationship with, a stuffed sock, and everybody kind of, and actually getting everybody on board with that, and helping them to understand that no, this man is going to make something truly magical, but you have to believe, you have to go on this journey. We tied two tables together, and Basil went off for an hour and cut out the outline of a boat, and then with masking tape he strapped the cardboard onto the you have to have a leap of faith and an imagination to be able to truly understand what it is that he's coming up with. But now the dancers can see what it is he's come up with, it's good for all of us to have that experience and to be with someone so childlike and so imaginative. Food for the soul.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
With that name, how is he not British?
Yeah, right.
I know.
Well, we do have a lot of British accents up here, and then I kind of love in the theater, if you are around the theater and you hear one of these. Ashley or Chris or Julian didn't seem to be mic'd yesterday, but you're definitely convinced that God has a British accent from all the booming voices for rehearsals. Maybe one more question and then we can end on, we can end on your rumination on Basil Twist, who is, I guess, not present to hear his work praised, but he is going to be speaking later this week along with Brian O'Selznick to some of the dancers and creatives involved.
Can we just one more thing before we finish, because I think it's really important that when you're spending millions of dollars on a new production and it's so complicated, and so time for us is the most valuable thing in the world, and having these 3 weeks here at Hancher to really get this production together has been phenomenal. So I just want to say, on behalf of the Joffrey Ballet, that Hancher and the university, believing in the Joffrey, supporting us, and giving us time, thank you. Yeah.